previously on your favorite episode.
In the salad days, to you, when he was like, you know, just trying to ease by. But now that it's fucking all out warfare, it's fuck you, fuck you.
Hello, and welcome to a brand new edition of your favorite episode. I am your host, Jackie, and joining me today is my partner and producer, Mickey.
Hi, I'm Mickey.
Our guest today is my internet friend, Christian Moore. Christian is the host of the Moon Room Comedy Showcase held every Tuesday at Pineapples in Melbourne, Florida's O'Galley Art District. He also helps me make websites and stuff. Today, we're talking about his favorite episode of television ever. What is it? Season 2, Episode 8 of Star Trek, The Next Generation, A Matter of Honor. Y'all ready to get into it? Let's go.
TV rots your brains.
That's absurd. TV only softens the brain like a ripe banana.
Television. Much of our future depends on the way we use this medium of communication.
Hello. Nice to see your face.
Hello. Yeah, after like, so long.
I know. I feel like I talk to you more than most human beings. You've met Mickey before, right? Yes.
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 Yeah, briefly, at that drawing comedy show, I think.
Yes.
Correct? Were you at that one?
Yes.
Okay, cool.
All right, I already recorded your intro, so we don't have to do that right now. So we can just, like, get into the meat of the show, really.
Sweet.
So you picked Season 2, Episode 8 of Star Trek The Next Generation, A Matter of Honor. What was it about this one that spoke to you? Like, what made you pick this as your favorite?
This one always stuck with me because I feel like if you wanted to onboard someone with what this show is about and what kind of Star Trek in general is about, I think this is a pretty decent episode. There's, of course, an A and a B plot. The most memorable thing is definitely the A plot with the second in command on the ship going to, like, he starts as like a grunt in this exchange program, and He, by the end of the episode, he's the captain of the ship. And it's like, this guy rules. And it's just super fun. But it also kind of gets the point across about Star Trek and Next Generation.
It was really my very first episode of Star Trek ever, to be honest with you.
Okay, how did you feel about that?
Well, I liked it. I can see why people latch onto it, for sure. But it was like, slower than I was expecting somehow. I don't know why I expected more action.
Yeah. Star Trek's basically a soap opera.
I watched, like, one of the movies had Christian Slater in it, so I had to see that one because I was, like, super into Christian Slater for a while. And then I watched, like, the new movie when the first one came out, but, like, that's it. That is my whole Star Trek experience, is Christian Slater and the new movie.
Gotcha.
And
yeah,
this was your first time.
Yeah, there's a lot to get into.
This was your first time too, right, Mickey?
I had seen a few episodes here and there, but like I was never really a fan. Like if it was on and the remote was across the room, I would leave it on, kind of thing.
Okay, so
I totally get it.
How did you get? Like, what made you get into Star Trek? Like, how did you start?
I'm extremely happy you asked that. I think a lot of people have a lot like deeper backstories on this. Literally, years and years ago, I saw this stupid YouTube video that was like it's like clips from the show turned into like this dumb dance song. And it's just, it's literally a clip of Patrick Stewart saying, "Captain Jean-Luc Picard of the USS Enterprise." And then it just like, there's this funky little beat to it, but it shows clips from all seasons of Star Trek. Cause by the time this was made, it was over. Mm-hmm. And it always just intrigued me how much stuff was happening. Like at some point there's like a mariachi band on the bridge of the, of the spaceship. Like, he wakes up and there's like a dude in his bed and he like fully clothed and he's just in his bed. And he's like, like he wasn't expecting him. I'm like, what is going on? What is Star Trek? Literally. Like, I thought it was something else, but I apparently have to check it out because it's bizarre.
Okay, well, I can understand that now.
Yeah.
So for people who have no idea about Star Trek, like, can you give like a little overview of the show or Star Trek The Next Generation?
It's Star Trek just in general is, you know, it's in the future. It's a science fiction spaceship based show for the most part. Every episode they're traveling to a different planet. Most of the different series, it's in the name of exploration. They often get into some kind of combat or struggle or something like that with various other alien races that are out there that have their own civilizations. A lot of it is about just how encountering new people with new customs and trying to navigate that and trying to get out of scrapes and stuff like that. It's very, a lot of it is very monster of the week. But The Next Generation kind of takes that and makes it, they start to incorporate a little bit more arc stuff, a little bit more overarching, you know, what's happening in the larger galaxy. The galaxy is our galaxy. It's not different like Star Wars. So, you know, there's Earth and all the other different planets, but it's a big, big place. And there's different like stellar nations, interstellar nations that like exist out there. And they start to get into the bigger story of how those interact. So I don't know. It's like I said, it's a space soap opera with some enough goofy action to kind of, I think if you're into the story, it'll keep you hooked just enough. Like,
I guess I wasn't prepared for the goofiness. Like there was a bit more goofy than I was expecting.
Oh,
and like when we started watching it, when we started watching it, I asked Mickey, I'm like, is this supposed to be campy or do like they lean into the camp? And I don't think that they do, but it's like, it's unintentionally campy.
It's so hard to tell. It's so hard to tell because it's like, I feel like this was, this would have been early 90s at this point for this series.
89.
Okay. 89. Yeah. So it's, are they being in earnest? Are they sort of making fun of like the earlier seasons or series even of this show? Riker is one of the goofiest characters ever because he's straight up a Mary Sue. He almost has no weaknesses. He's kind of like boss hog. Wherever he goes, and this is the episode that shows that, but it makes him being a Mary Sue fun because, like I said, he starts off and he's like studying how the Klingons eat so he can like get inside their psychology. And he's just, Jonathan Frakes, the actor who plays Riker, is just so, he's just so like, yes, you have to I love to eat Gagh. the worms that the Klingons eat. They're like, Gagh is best served live. You know, he's very.
And the way they moved when they were live.
I
was also not prepared for. I was also not prepared for Riker being as good looking as he was.
Oof!
That was the other first thing I said to Mickey. I was like, "Damn, who is that?"
he's a babe.
He is a babe. I wasn't expecting a space babe. Okay. So the episode you picked is called "A Matter of Honor," and just give a little bit of overview on like the episode as a whole, and then we'll start like breaking it down and like going step by step by step by step.
Yeah. So the basically there is this exchange program. That's the overarching thing that connects the two plots. And the one side of that is, in addition to the Klingon ship, is there is this Starfleet Academy. So students are also boarding the ship, trying to learn, you know, kind of how all the procedures work and the different stuff that's happening on the ship. And that involves this, God, I think it's called a Benzite. There's so many different aliens. but he's the one with the weird inhaler that sticks out in front of him like a like a solo harmonica. he's just very full of himself. And I feel like this character, Wesley, played by,
Wil
Wheaton. Remember the guy's name. Wil Wheaton.
Wil Wheaton, yes.
it's like I've deleted it from my memory. but he's
not a good
like
actor.
If, No.
Like,
giving child like, actors.
He was bad. Like, everyone is all Wil Wheaton. And I'm like, he wasn't good in this episode. He was just reading lines.
I had to warm up to Wil Wheaton really a lot because, I mean, he's, for even fans of this show, he's the most hated part of it.
Oh, really?
But I kind of think, he's so cheap. Even for a corny show, his corniness is like just over the top. And that's child actors. But I feel like this character is for the kids that are watching the show with their dad or whatever. So it's not just a bunch of like bald men going like, what do you presume we should do? You know, like there's finally like a guy who's like, I go to school. Like I try to date girls, like, you know, something to get new kids on board. And so he's kind of having to deal with this holier than thou, by the book, I'm going to like tattletale on everybody and, you know, try and make things better, but in sort of, he's this character, this alien character that's bugging Wil Wheaton, is the kid in class who raises his hand when the teacher to remind the teacher that like they have to give out homework. That's who this character is.
It was me.
Oh no.
That was me.
And true to, you know, just monster of the week arts, B plots, all that kind of stuff, by the end of the episode, everybody has understood each other. Everybody has kind of worked out the kinks in the chain of command, and, you know, hey, don't sell your bros out. You know, we're all trying to do starship stuff. So, you know, you're not getting, first of all, it's this like weird, they often call Star Trek, and this could be a brief description as well, fully automated luxury gay space communism. I feel like, yeah, they kind of dip into at times with this series. There's not, money isn't a thing here. So it's not like anybody's getting paid, you know, it's purely anyone who's positioning for power or clout, is those are the only two things. There's no money attached to it. It's literally just a guy who's like, I want to be over people. Like, I don't know. So it kind of drives that, you're kind of being a tool, like a little bit further home with that context. And so then to mirror that, you've got the adult plot, you know, meanwhile, back at the ranch, they're doing this, the Federation, which is a bunch of different alien races, has kind of been, they haven't been friendly with the Klingon Empire for, you know, years and years. If you watch the old series, they're the big enemies of that series, with William Shatner. But now they're trying to get along. So they're doing this officer exchange program, and Riker's like, absolutely, I want to go over there. I want to kick ass as a Klingon. I want to, like, because, and of course, it's like, who else on this, in this ship, human, who's a human, would fit the bill to stand toe-to-toe?
He just seems so open to experiences, and I really love that about his character. Like, he was down for literally anything.
That is a very, like, if you could have like a note about how to write this guy, that's exactly what it is. He's down for anything.
He's like the neighbor in Office Space. Two Klingons at the same time.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. They're all trying to intimidate him physically with the food, sexually. Like, there are two Klingon women that like try to, they're like, I like him, because just all the Klingons look pretty much the same. And he's, I think at one point, yeah, they ask him, so, you know, what they say they'd like to, you know, get to know you better. And then he's like, then he just basically says, I'd take both of them on at the same time. Like, yeah, and then they all laugh, like, he's unending so confidence. Awesome. But then in this side of the plot, the captain is kind of trying to test his loyalty. He's trying to get him to say, you know, what are the weapon frequencies, or what does the Enterprise have? Tell me about the secrets of the Enterprise. And Riker's like, nah, dude, no. They get in his face. They are about, Klingons are just, they'll kill you. They won't even think about it. Death is, like somebody dying, that's just Tuesday to them, you know. Well, like that's how they get big stuff fans done. Of
sorry, repeat that again. I'm sorry, I talked all over you.
No, you're good. They use assassination as like a promotion tactic. So if you got to keep your head on a swivel, if you're not looking in all directions and on your shit, your second officer is going to come at you with a knife, and then guess who's captain now? That guy. So
okay, I don't know. Did you see the movie Captain Phillips?
No, but I know.
I am the captain now. Line was delivered exactly like the dude in Captain Phillips, and I freaked the fuck out.
It's so good, yeah. Like so many years before,
so wild. But what I was going to say is the Klingons seem to be very big fans of death in general. Like,
man, and that's used to like. They use that sort of like rough and tough, like the blood sort of worship sacrifice, almost like this Aztec sort of vibe that they've got going on. They use that a lot to sort of prop up that when they have to have legal proceedings that cross over between these two civilizations, you know, a Klingon in a Federation court or a, God forbid, a human in a Klingon court, it's very different. And they show how, you know, You've got to be ruthless. You've got to be, and there's actually some good Patrick Stewart moments too, where he has to step up to the Klingons in the series. But yeah, like I said, they death before dishonor. I think they've got like a Valhalla type thing. They go to like some kind of, you know, fighting afterlife where they're fighting boys forever.
big wrestling ring.
Yeah. At one point, one of the Klingons, they're talking about their fathers and how their fathers died in battle. And then one Klingon is like ashamed because his father was captured and he wasn't allowed to die. And it's like,
he won't even talk to his dad anymore because he didn't die right.
Yeah. Like they cut you off. They are hardcore. And here's this like soft human with nice eyes in the middle of it.
Very nice. Can you imagine like the sad life of the people that didn't die right? Like, are they all exiled somewhere together? Do they get to be together, or are they all separate in their non-dying right death exile? Like, I need to know that.
I feel like they've got like a lot of stuff on the books of like, if you're dishonorable in this way, you are exiled. Dishonorable in this way, we kill you. Like, they're actually big on like keeping people alive as punishment. Like, because if it's Klingons, because, you know, death is the release. They get to go to and chill with their homies forever. So if you wish that you would have died, that's the last thing that the Klingon Empire will allow for. But you know, it's shown as like this fish out of water thing for Riker. And that's usually how it's played.
Yeah, he played it really well, too.
And I think you respect, up until now, you've seen a few Klingons here and there, and, you know, they all are, like, yelly, you know, they're just, they get on this, everyone's ship, they're like, you have to, where are your weapons? Fire upon them, you know, like, that's just their answer to everything. So you're like, man, what's wrong with you? So this is, like, a good episode that shows you what they're about, how they, why they think that, and it humanizes or alienizes, whatever the term is. It justifies it. It makes them a people rather than like just more accessible, like almost
like more accessible to normalies.
You almost feel like you could not visit, like visit this place now. Weirdly, mm-hmm. It feels like a culture. It feels like I don't know. Something real, I guess.
We have some acquaintances, some friends that we know that had like a full on Klingon wedding that was like in Klingon, full costume, full makeup. There was like dances and swords, and like they went like all the way in, all the way. And now knowing this about Klingons, that like it really makes me wonder. Like they seem very murdery.
Yeah, it's kind of like a goth wedding for nerds. You know, it's like instead of doing Nightmare Before Christmas, it's like, let's do Klingon, you know?
That tracks.
Or like
that
Vikings.
We've also been to a pirate wedding. We got some theme weddings happening.
If you, you know, if, heck, it's a, you're spending all this money. At least do something wild. Do something fun. Right.
Okay, so it starts out that the first thing that we see is them like talking about the exchange program, right? Like when they're bringing people on, that's the first thing at the beginning, right? Am I remembering?
Yeah, they kind of they kind of plop you right in with that. Yeah.
There was no easing us into the episode. It was just like, here's the action. Let's do it.
Yeah. Which, I mean, that they kind of try to get the basic idea out within that cold. I think that was the cold open even. So it's before the credits and the fanfare and all that. So, yeah, they try to go like, here is the basic idea of where we're going this episode.
Yeah, the whole time I was trying to figure out when the honor came in, like which direction they were going to go with the honor.
Who's got honor? Who needs honor? Is there going to be a deficit of honor? A surplus of honor by the end of this? I think we end up on honor.
Yeah. One of the things that tickled me about the cold opening scene was there was like a throwaway line when they meet Mendon. And Wesley Crusher was like, you guys all look alike. And then when Mickey was doing research for the episode, it's the same actor. It's the same actor. Play both. Of course they look alike.
And one of the reasons is in order to save money on the budget, the face mask that he was wearing, like the skull cap and all that stuff, was like, custom made to fit his head, so they just rehired him to wear the same costume so that they didn't have to remake another costume.
That's so funny. Also, I love how Wesley is, I mean, like, childishly, but it's like, it's immediately says like, oh, you guys all look the same. Like, whoa, dude, come on. It's like 2257.
Yeah, the 80s didn't predict people being accepting of other things.
It's funny because like that's always been a thing with this series. You hear people kind of harp on that about Star Trek. It's like, oh, it's about that, you know, almost calling it out on the carpet, because, you know, I think he even says something to that effect where he's like, not all Benzites are related, dude. Like, what do you mean? Like, what? I wouldn't ask you if you and Picard were related. You know, that's
The question was how do you tell each other apart? And the answer was we just do.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Like, dude, like, it's weird that you're drilling down on this, Wes. Like, but you know, he's 12 and Wil Wheaton, so we got to forgive him a little bit. But yeah, no, it's that, you know, they've got the old series had the episode, kind of famous episode where it was like two subspecies that they had differing sides of their face was black or white. And of course the one with the one hated the other and they thought they were the source of all the crime and stuff. And it's like, ah, okay. Yeah.
This is really obvious.
This isn't even, well, it was the 60s at that point, the 70s maybe at that point. So it's like, this isn't even subtext. We're not ready for that. We're just still on text. We're still right there.
Yeah, but I feel like even with the subtext and the full on text, the progress is still so slow that we still, to this day, have to keep doing the same kind of stories.
Well, it's, I don't want to be that guy, but maybe not enough people watch Star Trek. That's not true. That's not the end all be all, but boy, I do think it would help.
Well, I mean, yeah, based on what this taught about like acceptance of other cultures, and there again, we'll get to it later, but there was a scene with Endon and Wesley Crusher again that was like very good about accepting them, but we'll get there.
Yeah. Yeah, it flip-flops between those plots, so it's hard for me to remember exactly when certain twists happen. But yeah, I'm trying to think of where we were.
Basically, they're talking when Mendon just gets on, and then Picard suggests that they do a similar officer exchange with the Klingons, and then we have Riker volunteering, right. And then going through his Klingon meal, which was something.
And the doctor sits down within the ship. The ship's main medical officer sits down with him and is just like, "What are you eating?" and this is the beginning of Riker's like just 10, you know, out of 10 confidence all the time. Is he's like, "Oh, I'm, you know, it's Klingon food. You want some?" Like, he's nobody wants handing, some, dude. You're eating
handing
worms.
Him a glass that looks like with butterbeer with mushrooms on top of it.
It's so good.
There's and that so doctor many mushrooms in that meal.
I think that's Pulaski, and she's just, that's her entire character is just super, she's like, "Oh, all right, hey, whatever, your funeral. I mean, I'll fix you up, but this is a bad idea. This food is an omen of things to come."
It made me really happy to see her on screen too, because I had forgotten what it looked like for TV actresses to age naturally. Like,
oh, it was exciting to
see her normal face, a human face. And now, like, I made notes and I wrote down something like, the actresses now look more alien than the alien actors did then. And I don't know.
Well, now we're, like, going in and doing, like, digital stuff to people. Like, mm-hmm. I don't even know at any point if I'm even... Like, I think in the Suicide Squad movie, the first one they did with Margot Robbie... I heard somewhere that they like shortened her shorts digitally, and I'm like, like, what are we doing, guys? Like, what? This is,
well, it's like that old philosophy thing where if you have a boat and then you repair it bit by bit, how much of the original boat is left over? It's like that with actors' faces nowadays. Like, are they even themselves anymore?
You know, thank God for Betty White really keeping the flame alive that, you know, it's okay to fucking be a normal person.
Yeah.
Ooh, she came on the scene looking like a grandma, so she rules.
It's wild to think about. I think I mentioned this when we did an episode about Sex and the City a while ago, but the Sex and the City ladies in the latest series are the same age as the Golden Girls were in their series. And just the different way that women of that age were portrayed then and now is wild.
Mm-hmm. I feel like Sex and the City probably going to be a little more honest about it though, which is probably something that should be. I mean, Golden Girls wasn't bad, but you know, I mean, sex. It's called Sex and the City. There's definitely a little bit of a knob is being turned up.
Yes.
So to
speak. Okay, so. Did you know that this was the first appearance of, however you say it, Garg, Gug, Gog, Gog? How do you say it?
Gog.
Yes.
Gog. It's got that. Yes. It's got that cool Gagh. Sort of Scottish on it.
Yes.
It has. And so does the ship, the Pach.
It's the first appearance of it. Would you try it?
Oh God, no, no. I would be stabbed in the stomach so fast on that Klingon ship. It's not even funny.
So that was what I thought this easier. Entire time.
Yeah, I'm a replicator boy. I'm just going to get like a grilled cheese sandwich from the computer. Like, that's why I love Star Trek. I'm like, I just want this to be real. I want to be in space and like tell a computer, get me an Oreo sundae. And it
Wait,
just
there's a replicator
it.
In Star Trek?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's how they eat and everything.
Wait. our stuffies have a replicator. Did you get that from Star Trek, Mickey?
No, we got it from the Orville.
Oh, okay. That's right. We did get it from the Orville.
Which is based on Star Trek.
I love the Orville.
Oh, that's a good, honestly, that's a good back door into Star Trek. But also, it's good enough on its own that you can kind of leave it there.
I don't want to watch the new season because I'm sad because there's no Norm MacDonald in it.
Oh, that I didn't even think about that. It's going to hit hard.
It's going to make me so sad. Because, I don't know, I feel like they got to deal with it. I feel like Seth MacFarlane wouldn't not deal with it. I don't know. It is space.
You know, I got to say about Seth MacFarlane, and it's really with the Orville that this... I feel like, obviously, he's a huge Star Trek nerd, or else he would not be making this show. But I feel like all of the... kind of offshoots and stuff that he does that I'm not as big a fan of. Like the seasons of Family Guy have just not been almost really coherent, even let alone funny. American Dad kind of really went down the tubes as well. But I feel like all of that was, all of the success of that was to, he leveraged that to be like, I want to make Star Trek. I want to make a funny Star Trek show, but I want to make
Star Trek. I can see him leveraging the money bags to make his love. I can see that 100%.
And as soon as I kind of realized that watching the Orville, I was like, oh, my respect for this dude just like shot up like 450%. Just like he's a cooler dude than I had realized. He's the cooler of the McFarlane cousins for sure.
I unabashedly adore the Cleveland Show. Like I will watch episodes of that unendingly. I love the Cleveland Show. I'm not embarrassed about it.
No, you shouldn't be. I mean, by that point, I didn't even check in on the Cleveland Show because by that point they had done like two offshoots and everything. All the animation just started to look like that. And I was like, I'm good. I'm good.
Yeah, I binge stuff a lot while I work and I tried to binge Family Guy and I couldn't do it. It's too much happening too much of the time. And it's like always on. That, like, there's no downtime in Family Guy.
It's like an interview with Robin Williams.
That's so true. I've never realized it, but it's basically the Family Guy episodes since season three are basically just Robin Williams B-roll. Like, all of the jokes that he didn't fit in.
Stop it! You stop it! Robin Williams has a manic gift that gladdens a sad world! And all he asks in return is our unceasing attention.
Oh, all man. Right. Yeah, it's too random.
So he's eating his gross food, and then Worf brings him like a little technology thing. And what does this piece of technology do? It was like some kind of transponder, but also seemed like a secret?
That's going to be so that in case anything really goes down, because, you know, like I said, the relationship between these two, let's call them countries or nations, has been pretty fraught for a long time. So, and as you soon find out, as soon as he gets on the ship, you know, the Klingons have their own, they're up to their own shit. They're trying to kind of pull their own stuff. So I believe that's a beacon to allow them to lock on to him in case they need to transport him off the ship. So it's kind of like an insurance thing that he's not supposed to tell him about because the whole thing is a trust exercise, but still they're kind of like, ah. But what was this? Oh, yeah. And they also, I forgot, they also find something on the hull.
And yes, it's on, Mendon finds something and he doesn't know what to do about it.
Well, his culture is that he has to have, he can't bring it forward until he has a solution to the problem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Which, again, like man, I actually kind of undersold or under kind of forgot the Bensite angle on this, where there's actually like a couple of cultural clashes happening. Mm-hmm. Where, yeah, like there's is a very rigid culture as well, but in a polite way, where the Klingons are of course very rude and very brash. And kill everybody. but yeah, no. And there was also a thing where the Bensite, he said at one point they said people pleasers, and Picard says, ah, well, you know, that's kind of Bensites for you. You know, a little touch of the old space racism there, but
oh, I was thinking Bensites were 100% autistic.
you know, honestly.
Yeah, going through that episode and watching from front to back, it absolutely is 100% autistic. I think it was inadvertent by the writers, but like in 1989, an adult person like Jackie or me, or I'm assuming Christian as well, couldn't explain it in hey, this is an autistic race, blah blah blah. So we're going to include these traits. They're just wrote is like. Here, this
my
is
my kind
me.
Of people.
I'm gonna write this person into there and sneak it into the thing because no one's gonna notice. And here we are, like 30 years later, going, "Oh my God, it's us!"
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. The scene a with race him and like Leslie math Parker. Nerds.
Yeah, yeah. Not getting the social cue. And it's both of them don't get social cues, although Wesley does cop to it a little bit, or he gets a grab on it a little bit sooner. But yeah, no, they're both kind of autisticking at each other.
And
I don't know if that's Wesley's bad acting or what.
The thing that was kind of beautiful to me is, like, I understood when Mendon was like, when Wesley was like, the exchange program is about learning the way we do things and taking the information back to your command, and it's up to them to decide which is better. And once Mendon realizes that he wasn't like on the hook for anything, he was just there to observe and bring information back, he felt so much better because he didn't feel responsible for like fixing things. He just is responsible for giving the information. As an autistic person myself, once I know exactly what my purpose is, everything becomes so much easier. Otherwise, I'm just trying to do all of the things hope that one of those is the purpose. So I felt that so hard.
Knowing which cog you are in the machine is definitely super helpful, I think, for anybody. But yeah, especially autistic people and Benzites, as it turns out. But as you watch the show, I think you do find, because so many alien races have to be like sort of scientifically, some of them even have like scientifically led governments. You actually probably, I never thought about it with this lens before, but boy, there's probably, the galaxy's probably majority autistic. If but I'm thinking
we
about
it. We talk about that literally all the time. We talk about that all the time.
Like, it really is. I mean, if you even the Borg, which are like that, you want to talk that maybe that's the logical end of all. Like, you just increase your intelligence enough to the point where it's like, nope, let's just, it's easier if we're all one brain. It's easier.
Oh my God.
I figured it out, guys.
This is going to go really well with our next episode that we're recording, too. Oh my God.
Oh, that's so great. What is it?
Mickey, cut this part out. Cut this part out, okay?
Why?
Because I don't want the people who are listening to the episode to know what the next episode's going to be.
Okay, fine.
Fair enough, yeah.
Our next episode is going to be with...
Oh, boy. Okay, yeah, okay. I can see why that would be like a good... That's a good shoe drop, so yeah.
Yep. It's going to be a good lead-in from this one.
I love that person, and I love that episode of that show, so that's going to be great. and clap or whatever you do. Yeah. Yeah, so basically this thing that Mendon discovers, it's some kind of organism eating at the way of the hulls of both the ships, and the Klingon, now Riker's over on the Klingon ship doing his exchange. The Klingon guy thinks it's the Enterprise doing it. And he thinks that the Enterprise that the Enterprise planted it there because they did like a deep scan. I don't know how you can kind of transplant something there with a scan, but maybe he thought it was like a surreptitious thing to cover it up.
Did we ever find out where it actually came from?
You know, well, welcome to Star Trek. It doesn't look like it, like we do.
Okay.
It came from the script. It came from the script.
Yeah.
It was written into the script, and there it was.
And to it's the like script Susie's it returned. Yeah, it's really just like, I mean, it's space problem number 76. You know, that's kind of what. Yeah, I mean, God, that's so funny. I'm just looking at it to refresh my memory, and yeah, no, they do not mention at all where the organism. There's just an organism, which is funny because it's like in any other show, the organism eating the hull would be like probably the plot of the whole episode. So like this in this one, it's just like, hey, you know, sometimes you get organisms. I don't know, man. It's space.
And then the Klingon dude was like, in a couple hours, our whole ship will be ate up, basically. Just casual about it.
Yeah. Yeah. And of course, they are ready for that because they spend every waking moment thinking about how they're going to kick it.
Dying from a bacteria count as being an honorable death, though, because it seems kind of lame to get dead by a bacteria.
There's probably Klingons that would definitely agree with you, but I think if it was a weapon by the enemy, then I think it sort of counts as like they get to go down with their ship, kind of.
If it's intentional bacteria, it's honorable. If it's accidental bacteria, you're just sad.
Like if they shoot like a ball of termites at a Viking ship, and then the Viking ship gets eaten up by termites and they sink, do they go to Valhalla?
I don't know. Boy, I do not know the Viking
previously
rules.
Previously unsaid sentences in human history. we're doing groundbreaking work on this show. That's a really good question. Because also, I mean, Vikings would not have had the ability to combat termites in the day that they were, you know, that they were active. There's, you know, they don't know pest control. They just know their ship's sinking. So I don't know. Do they just, you know, captain of the Titanic it and like salute and be like, all right. Here I come, Loki, or whoever. Loki and all his buds.
I'm also now really wondering, like, what happened to the Klingons to make them so angry? Like, what happened? Because building up defenses that big, they've gone through some trauma.
I mean, definitely, I want to say their homeworld went through lots of probably both industrial and natural disasters, like any kind of, I think they kind of mirror us up to a point, and then their civilization gets so bad, their planet becomes so almost uninhabitable that they turn to this more warlike, more attrition-based civilization, probably because resources were so tight. And they built that up. They became so strong from that new empire that they're just like, hey, you know what? I get it. A lot of people probably die that don't need to, quote unquote, but if it ain't broke, don't fix it. We're out here in space. We made it.
What if on the very last episode / movie / YouTube show, whatever the last part of Star Trek is going to be, it's like a Planet of the Apes things where the Klingons were the humans all along.
And we evolve into them. That would be beautiful. I would honestly love that so much. you can do anything with Star Trek. They've like rewritten the whole timeline like 8 times because time travel is weirdly common in this program, across all of its series.
Are you a Doctor Who person too? Because I feel like people pick like one long-term series and that's it. They don't do like all of them.
I was very into Doctor Who before I think I ever got into Star Trek. Actually kind of got into them around the same time. One was on BBC and one of them was on like, I think Sci-Fi or something at the time. So I just sort of between that I stuck to Doctor Who a little more because it was a little newer. Mm-hmm. My brain couldn't override the, like, at that time I was trying to do the original series. So I'm like, I'm going way back. Like I'm having to put on some serious, you know, way back goggles to deal with how cheesy everything looks and everyone acts and all that. I think you can enjoy both.
The Klingon makeup in Klingon lighting versus, normal spaceship lighting is something. Like the lighting was really working for him on the Klingon ship.
On the Enterprise, everything is well lit. It's got like, you know, ensconced lighting. There's really some interior design work that went into it. I think there's wood grain on the chairs on the bridge. Everything is very nice.
It's very upscale.
It looks like the inside of a Cadillac. Like it's amazing. And then Riker beams over to this Klingon ship and it's just like, it's got like pipes hanging from the, like there's hoses and netting. Like it's so great. I don't know if it's this episode, but they at one point they show how Klingons sleep and it's literally just on like a slab that's like jutting out from the deck. Like, of course, that's how they sleep. Hardcore. You can't have a moment's comfort in your entire life.
They gotta be ready for battle. You know,
not, They got to be ready for battle. You got to be kind of angry, a little bit, just a little bit like grumpy all the time. That's what they all sound like. They need coffee. Every Klingon.
I want to I want a series that's like introducing Klingons to comfortable things, like see how much easier Klingon's life is after a good night's sleep on a comfortable bed. I don't even know Worf's, much about the show, but I need this.
Worf is a good character to follow for that, because he's the resident Klingon. So mm-hmm. when people try, he has people in his life that are like, "Hey, man, you should relax." And of course, it's growly Michael Dorn going, "What reason? Klingon does not relax. We do not have a word for it." You know, he's like constantly like, "All right, man." And by the way, if you want to talk about autistic characters, if you look at Worf through the lens of autism, I mean, it's so good, because he's trying to be Klingon, and but he kind of doesn't have all of the upbringing and all of that, but he wants to be super hardcore, so he's kind of like. He's like the guy who's not, he's got like 2% Viking in him, but he's all about like the, so he's just like constantly like, "I will raise my son in the Klingon tradition."
Kind of like Daniel LaRusso learning karate out of a book.
Oh God, fuck Daniel LaRusso. That guy is the source of all of his problems.
That's so
Sorry, we just finished the new season of Cobra Kai. That show is ridiculous in the best way. I hate it, and I love it.
It seems like there's like a rash of those shows like that in Riverdale, where it's like they're making these bizarre hyper camp 80s pastiche kind of things.
Riverdale was good for like the first two seasons, and then I don't know what the fuck happened to it. It is unwatchable now. And I'll watch
every time I hear. It's like the Dark Tower. Like every time someone mentions Riverdale, it's like they're like, "Oh yeah," and then he builds a rocket ship and he launches himself out of it, and then they summon a demon, and I'm like, "Is this the same show? This is the same show." It seems like it's pulling from some weird. The Riverdale thing is pulling from that weird era of Archie where they started to make it dark because Archie is so pure, so they like inverted the morality. Like, what if Archie was fucked up, you know?
It's like Jughead's the best part of Archie. I mean, of Riverdale. Jughead is the best part of the show. The thing that I love about Cobra Kai is they keep bringing back the tiniest characters from the movies. They're like, "This guy was mentioned one time, let's make him a villain this season." Beautiful.
Yes.
Beautiful.
The like the lingering cameo. Like where the camera just like it sticks on him just a little bit too long, the music goes a little bit too sentimental, and you're kind of like, if you're watching this for the first time, you're like, "Am I supposed to know who that guy is? This like this visibly aged man?" Like, it's just like, "Hey, you need help?" And then like boom, credits, you know, like like, I guess that was important.
Oh, no.
Like, the next time you come around, like, they open up the very next episode with a flashback.
Yeah.
And say, "Here's the guy. Here's the guy." Like, they don't sure leave it up to chance. They make sure you know with a lot of flashbacks.
And, like, every time he's on screen again, they make sure you know. They're like, "This is the guy that did this, and now he owns a furniture store, and that furniture store got burned down by this other karate guy."
It's the legacy best, sequel, because in Star Wars, in these new Star Wars, they did that pretty much all three of those movies. They just like, they're like, "Hey, remember me?" Like, and then like, "Oh," like, it's like, "Yeah, no, I get it. It's Leia." Like what did you guys watch those? I don't know if you're Star Wars fans.
I watched
Obi-Wan.
Oh, okay, yeah. I mean, hey, that's probably better than these movies that came out. But at one point, like, Lando just shows up. Like, they have to meet someone, and it's like, surprise, it's Lando. And I'm like, there's 9 people in this galaxy, apparently. Like, how are we on some like crazy adventure so far from home, and we just happen to run into the same smooth talking Billy D. Williams from the last movies? Like, come on. This one's a little bit much for me.
I don't care. I'll put Lando anywhere. I'm happy. I do.
Honestly, yes,
Lando.
Though, is the other side of that is that I'm not going to get mad at Billy Dee Williams being anywhere ever. Colt 45, it always goes down smooth.
Yeah, and fucking Donald Glover, too. I'll take them both.
Yeah. Yeah. An underrated. Solo's underrated. But boy, we sure did get up on a tangent.
it happens. Okay, so. All right, so the organism is eating at the ships. And
it's gonna destroy the Klingon ship, apparently.
Yes, and they want the Klingon ship to cloak itself and return and attack the Enterprise, because that's the immediate reaction, is attack.
They're just like, they have attacked us, we have to attack them for honor so we can go to Alien Valhalla. And Riker's like, hey, yo, what, hold up. And they're like, nope, that's not how we do stuff. And so, true to Riker's nature, of course, he begins his alternate problem solving. He goes to his plan B, he tries it his way, and then he goes to his plan B, which is the Klingon way. And he just basically kind of bullies everyone on the ship until he becomes captain for, like, long enough to ensure he relieves the captain of duty, because he makes, like, this argument that's like, listen, I know y'all want to die, like, all the time. That's cool. But that's not what this is. Like, this, you know, this is just suicide. There's a difference between an honorable death in battle against an enemy and a misunderstanding where you just become suicidal from the jump. So I think he, like, just, like, you know, karate chops the frickin' captain, knocks him out, does the Phillips move. He says, I'm the captain now. And then he says, we're still going to attack them, but we're going to do it my way, first of all. And we're going to do it closer and in such a way that he's able to kind of get off a signal, basically, to the Enterprise, mm-hmm. so that they know, oh, first of all, like, I think at some point before they even get comms back, I think at some point he's like, that's a Riker move. This is like something Riker would do. This isn't something like a Klingon would do. This is something Riker would do. And then, of course, at the end, shit-eating grin, he, like, pops onto the view screen. He's like, hello, Captain. You know?
It was pretty
sitting
great.
In the Klingon's captain chair.
And then beaming the Klingon dude onto the Enterprise.
But yeah, beaming him onto the Enterprise to fucking give him literally putting him in timeout. Because he was getting so hype.
hype to die.
Like, so hype, like, and it's, again, we come back into the, like, you think you understand what these dudes are about. And then it's like, no, we're not, we haven't lived this long by just being, like, running at the enemy, guns blazing. We have intelligence, we have tactics that we have to employ. But I think that because Riker just kind of could figure out what was going on with the organism and that it was happening to both ships, they didn't realize that it was happening to the Enterprise ship as well. And I think Riker didn't either. So he has nothing, basically, he has no leverage against the Klingons. So he, like I said, he has to strong arm them and go, listen, this is what's going on, okay? Now let's attack the Enterprise. Like, he does do it, which I think is still great. Like, he's, I'll attack my homies. Like, I swore an oath to the captain now.
It was legitimately one of the most diplomatic things I feel like I've ever seen, because he was able to uphold honor for, like, everyone. Everyone.
Yeah, no. Like, a Mary Sue, you know, he walks into it with, like, zero. He's literally just, you know, whatever the maximum charisma modifier you can have in D&D. That's basically, he's just min-maxed to be Mr. Charisma. And he gets into and out of scrapes that way. He's a bit of a ladies' man.
I can see it.
Boy, they sure stretch, you know, it's ladies. It's not human ladies. It's ladies. If they remade it today, he would definitely be like, bi, pansexual, whatever. Like, that's how you reboot Riker, I feel. Which they, boy, now that I'm saying it, pretty good idea.
call it reboot Riker.
Reboot Riker. Yeah, I would watch Riker.
There could be like a whole reality show on the side of it where you're casting him, and then there's the actual show. Could be a thing.
No, I love, so, and Jonathan Frakes, the actor, is also, this happens with a lot of these guys, he gets very involved in the production of Star Trek, too. So he's written a lot of episodes, he's directed a lot of episodes. It's just kind of a testament to, I guess, that you don't see that often with people that work on shows like that. Like, you know, you're not seeing Sarah Michelle Gellar direct an episode of Buffy the Vampire Slayer, even though she was on that show for 7 years. But like, you know, Frakes will just come in and be like, yo, what do you need? A cool space story? I'm down. Like, I mean, let me see if I can whip something up.
When we do these episodes, editions of our podcast, I do a lot of research and I really find some weird things. And one of the things that I found was about the editor for this episode. Like, normally when I research like all the behind the scenes people, it seemed like they worked on The Next Generation and then they didn't do anything else after that. Like, that was it. That was the peak of their career. But the editor was a dude named William Hoy. He edited The Batman this year, so he's still doing shit. He
nice.
He also edited Sucker Punch. It's not an important movie, but the editing was really good. Dances with Wolves, Outbreak, two Fantastic Four movies, Watchmen, and Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter. But his very first job was a TV miniseries called The Atlanta Child Murders, and it starred Jason Robards, James Earl Jones, Rip Torn, Morgan Freeman, Ruby Dee, and Bill motherfucking Paxton.
Holy God.
Like, the cast on that is massive. And the murders that the miniseries was based on prompted the first extensive use of serial killer profiling and forensic fiber analysis.
Whoa, so William Hoy might be responsible for the people being interested in serial killers.
Yes.
In a major way.
Yes. He's responsible for murder podcasts.
What a resume. What a resume. Right.
And then this
episode
effects,
of Star Trek, like, sorry, go ahead.
The special effects makeup artist for this episode, Michael Mills, he did you might be too young for this, but do you remember Captain EO at Disney, that Michael Jackson thing?
No.
Oh, he did the makeup for that. Do you remember that, Mickey? Do you remember Captain EO?
Yes.
Okay, good. Can you explain what Captain EO is?
Not really.
Me neither.
Oh my God, it's a 3D science fiction short film
at Disney with Michael Jackson.
Oh my God. You know, we really did peak. We really have peaked as a nation and a culture. We just did. God. Yeah, they did do Moonwalker. I have to know Captain EO video game. Is very intriguing to me. Captain EO. I'll figure that later. Okay. I know that they did Moonwalker, which is a bizarre thing.
Yeah.
The other thing that I found out about this episode was one of the story writers. This is the only thing that she has ever done was created the story for this episode. The only thing in Hollywood she's ever done. Her name is Wanda M. Haight, H-A-I-G-H-T. She is a woman of color because I did a deep dive on her because I'm fascinated by this being the only thing that she's ever done. And she is a woman of color. She has been on some sci-fi like panels at Comic-Cons and stuff, but not since like 2004. So if anybody can tell me anything else about this woman, I would love to know more because I am fascinated. End of transmission.
Yeah, and a cool subject matter to cover, like for your only story in Star Trek, I think. I love anytime the Klingons show up, just because I find, because of this episode, I think I find their culture so honestly fascinating, much more so than I think you would think from a from looking from the outside in, not really knowing the context of everything of what Star, it's easy to look at Star Trek in general and just be like, ah, yes, okay, the show where they show space aliens with like ridges on their foreheads, and that's how you do different aliens. Like, but they, yeah, sure. Some guy put six ridges on some guy's head, you know, 45 years ago, and we've been talking about it ever since. But they go so far into that that I think you just you have to appreciate the work at least that goes into making this fictional culture so well realized. And, you know, all of their ships have a certain look. All of their buildings have a certain look. Very stark, very sharp, very, ah, you know, just like they are.
World building is such an amazing skill. Like, that's one of my favorite things about superhero movies is the first one when the world is new and you're learning it all and you're learning about all of the things in it. And that's one of my favorites. I love that. I think we did the thing. Do you think we did the thing?
Well, did you want to talk about the guy that played Clag?
Yeah, go ahead.
Clark.
Yes.
So Brian Thompson is like, to me, I recognized him instantly because I watched Cobra, the movie with Sylvester Stallone, like a million times. But he initially got the part to play a Klingon, and then he got a call saying basically that he was being cut from the cast, and he kind of stormed into their office and wanted to know why. And they were like, well, unfortunately, we don't have budget to make another costume, and you don't fit the one that Christopher Lloyd used in The Search for Spock. And that's the only extra Klingon costume we have. So he basically said, I will take this home and I will make the alterations myself. I want this part, please. So they gave him the part if he could come back, you know, if he could make the alterations himself. And then he went on to do four other parts throughout the Star Trek family, basically.
That is so rad.
Yeah, like he was so into it. He's like, I want this part.
There's a couple of actors, definitely, as someone who has, I basically in 2000 and God, I want to say 19, I basically just decided I'm going to sit down and I'm going to watch Star Wars in release or Star Trek in release order. I'm just going to go from episode one of the original Star Trek. I'm going to go all the way until I hit whatever's out now. And you do start to see they love to use those same actors when they get them. You'll see him show up and you'll hear the voice and you'll go, oh, it's that guy. It is that guy, though. I know it. throughout even multiple series. And it's always just like, yes, I love this dude. I love that he's a snake now for some reason, you know. but yeah, the passion of like, I want to. Also that it was literally like they made it for Christopher Lloyd. And they're like, listen, we got this piece of crap. I don't know. Like, he's like, it would be an honor to use this piece. I will fix it myself. That's so dope. And it just goes to show you, like, I don't know if you guys have seen, what's that called? The Movies That Made Us or whatever, the Netflix documentary series. You start watching that and pick a movie. It's amazing that anything gets made. It's astounding that anyone, I can't get like three people to agree on something in the world of like stand-up comedy, like a something simple. Getting all of these people to work together on a silly sci-fi show with rubber masks and puppets and like effects that, let's be honest, just don't hold up like they probably did in the day that they were made. To say the very least, like, it's astounding that everyone's like, I'm so passionate. I'm going to do work for free, like hard work off the clock, work through the night so that I can just be in this thing for a little bit. I'm not even like the main guy. I'm just, it's super heartwarming and cool. And I love fandoms, to a degree, like, you know, sometimes they get real rotten, but like, I feel like the Star Trek fandom is definitely like one of the first, and I think they're one of the most like warm, welcoming, passionate ones. Maybe almost to a weird degree, getting married in Klingon. But
hey, it made them happy.
It's like, no, exactly. Like it makes me happy because it's like I wish I love Star Trek a lot. I don't even think I love it that much. Like that's awesome.
It is pretty amazing. So, okay, I have two more questions and then we're done. When you are binging a show, do you watch the theme song?
Almost. I want to say usually I watch every iteration of the theme song, except sometimes I'll usually skip it twice throughout a binge, just because like, just for whatever reason, I'm like, I'm running out the door. I just want to get this episode, you know, in kind of thing. Or whatever the case may be. If, fun fact, if you want to listen to the worst theme song that's ever been written, Google Star Trek Enterprise theme song and prepare to be surprised.
I'm sure Mickey will insert it right here.
It's been a long road getting from there to here. It's been a long time, but my time is finally near. I will see my dream come alive at last. I will touch the sky, and they're not gonna hold me down no more. No, they're not gonna change my mind, 'cause I've got faith into the heart.
So if people like hearing you talk about television and they would like to keep up with you, how can they do that?
I am on Facebook, obviously, although I don't think that's, you could have me if you want. I'm on Instagram. That's usually just pictures. Actually, you know what, a great place to listen to me talk about this sort of thing is I have a podcast with a couple of friends of mine called All in the Comic Book. And that's on Spotify, wherever you get your podcasts. And basically we just do a podcast or a comic book character a week. And we really stretch that definition. I think the last one we did was Barbie. Yes, that Barbie.
Well, that movie's coming out. Good timing.
And she had, several comics. She had several comics.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Did they technically appear in a comic book, even if it was after it was a toy or whatever? We'll still mess around with that. But it is a lot of like Marvel and DC stuff. But it's a lot of like D-list guys and C-list guys that maybe you would not normally go like, I'm going to read a whole comic of this. You know, we'll just look at like the lesser known Green Lanterns or, you know, something like that. Blue Beetle, you know, something. Maybe less people are, but something you might want to know about. I don't know. So yeah, All in the Comic Book. And I think that's pretty much the best way to get
and you have a healthy show, helping right? of me.
I do have a comedy show. If you are in real space, if you want to come to the meat world where we all live, we do Moon Room Comedy, and that's at Pineapples in O'Galley in Melbourne, Florida. And that's every Tuesday at 8. If you like comedy, we've got actually a bunch of like Orlando guys out pretty much every week if we can get it. I don't want to drop names. I don't know if that's classy or not, but if you're listening to this show, you probably know Orlando Comedy. I think we've had Ross came to the other show, actually. Ross McCoy, the Beachside Retro show, which Jimmy runs. That's Fridays, but it's on a weird schedule, so I don't even know how to plug it. but Joe Sensabella's come out, Robin Love, Vinny DiLorenzo, bunch of newer kids. Yeah, Vinny DiLorenzo is he's a trip.
He's dark, and I love it.
I do. I love that guy. But yeah, no, it's a good time. So, podcast, show, whichever, come at me.
Well, this was very fun. Thank you for talking about your favorite episode of television with us.
Oh, yeah. Thank you for letting me ramble on endlessly about Star Trek.
It was great. I feel like I learned a lot of things, and that's always what I want to do. And I never know how to end anything, so I'm just going to end it awkwardly here and say the show is over, and now we're just being friends and talking.
Chill. That's awesome. Oh, boy. Hey,
thank you. Yeah. That was fun.
Yeah, I love, man, I'm ever since I've been, you know, let's call it a casually employed, it's sort of this thing where you're like, man, I should fill this time with like something, you know, lots of people, this is their time that they start a podcast or do something. So it's nice to be able to just do this. It makes me feel like I'm doing some kind of like press junket or tour or something. Like, I'm like, yes. So it's awesome to just, I love that people make fun of the fact that everyone has a podcast. I love that everyone's got like a dumb little talk show, you know?
Yeah. It's like a little whatever. Outlet. What?
Yeah. Like, what? Like I'm a loser because I'm not a millionaire from it. Like, come on. Like they're fun to make. They're easy to make, mm-hmm. you know, and hey, maybe, I don't know, maybe some little scratch will come, you know, our way if we do it enough. Yeah. So it's, I don't know. I love doing it. And this is a great idea. I love podcasts with a central kind of core. We're just going to do one episode. You know, we're going to do one character. I don't know if you've ever listened. I think you said you listened to the dollop.
No, I haven't.
Big dollop. Oh, okay. That one's like a deep dives into like historical events that you may not be aware of, but it's a couple of comedians doing it. And the one guy doesn't know anything about the topic at all, and the other guy has like done exhaustive research on it, so he's just constantly responding. Honestly, that podcast probably radicalized me.
See, I listened to a podcast called Hardcore History, and it was like the guy opens up, he's like, yeah, we started digging into this topic, and we were going to split it up into a couple episodes, but we didn't know where to split it up. And I looked down, and it's like 5 hours and 49 minutes for one episode. Like, all right, this will get me through the night.
That's Dan Carlin's Hardcore History, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah, that's if that's like one of those where I think everyone needs to sit down and listen to that big World War One thing that he did. Because,
oh, yeah,
man, you learn very quickly that like, oh, this is why the world is the way it is. Like this right here is how the countries are, why they are there and in that shape and all that. It's that was like eye opening. If anyone hasn't listened to that, that's maybe one of the first podcasts I throw out. I think Jackie froze.
All right. Well, I guess we'll call that at the end.
Yeah. It was nice talking to you.
Yes, absolutely. And I do appreciate the work that you've done for Jackie. It has made her life amazingly easy, and she's extremely happy working with you. So,
oh man, she's a lifesaver, man. That was like, because this is all basically, you know, huge stuff for me to move into doing that kind of work. So, you know, now I've actually built up a resume. So. It's awesome.
I'm very happy it's working out for you, because I know it's like she has, you know, expanded her ability to reach out to different customers and stuff, and now she feels without limits on her resume on what she can offer. So, you know, it's amazing watching you two work. So, thank you for that.
That's awesome. Oh yeah, no problem. Right. Appreciate it.
All right, man. Have a good one, and we'll talk to you guys later.
Yes, sir. You have a good one.
Here's to the finest crew in Starfleet.
Engage.
Captain Jean-Luc Picard of the USS Enterprise. Captain Jean-Luc Picard of the USS
officer is to the truth, scientific truth, or historical truth.
kept talking in one long, incredibly unbroken sentence, moving from topic to topic so that no one had the chance to interrupt. It was really quite hypnotic, incredibly unbroken sentence, moving from topic to topic, incredibly unbroken sentence, moving from topic to topic, moving from topic to topic, quite hypnotic, incredibly unbroken sentence, moving from topic to topic, incredibly unbroken sentence, moving from topic to topic, moving from topic to topic, quite hypnotic, incredibly unbroken sentence, moving from topic to topic, incredibly unbroken sentence, moving from topic to topic, moving from topic to topic, quite hypnotic,
You'll have to call again. I'm just leaving. I'm not dressed properly.
My love is a fever, long in tail for that which longer nurseth the disease. You'll have to call again. In faith, I do not love thee. With mine eyes, they be a thousand heresy. But 'tis my heart that loves what they despise. Whom in despite of you are pleased to do. Shall I compare thee to a summer's day?
To my questions. I am Locutus of Borg. You are Borg. I am Locutus of Borg. You will assist us. I am Locutus of Borg. You are Borg. I am Locutus of Borg. Lock phases on that vessel. I am Locutus of Borg. There are four lights.